Hey, Highland Valley, welcome to the journey.
We're celebrating again.
Yes, we are celebrating administration, facilities, and grounds this week.
Yeah,
so we're going to find out what it takes to make everything happen here at Highland Valley on campus. So we're going to hear from our Board of Trustees Chair, Julia Baldwin, and we're going to hear from Herrn Northcutt,
yes,
who helps us with a lot of our repairs. He's always up here doing so much. And then we're going to hear once again from Tami Bean. Yeah, so facilities and grounds. What do you think of?
I think of the buildings.
Right.
And all the grass and the trees and the shrubs, the grounds. But I forgot about the pavement. And we had that redone this year.
Yeah, we did.
And changing light bulbs and all the cleaning and sanitizing and new tables, and it's a lot.
Right. There is a lot that goes into it. And what I think, the first thing that pops into my head when I think about the facilities is this wonderful space that we've been given through God's faithfulness, through your gifts that have made this space a possibility, a reality. But what can we do with it? We know that worship takes place here. And we know that discipleship takes place here, all of our education and everything. Of course, right now we're having to do a lot of that virtually, but there's still a lot that goes on. But then something that we're going to talk about next week, I think of our mission and outreach. So much of that comes from these facilities. If we didn't have these facilities here, we couldn't go out into the world and be the hands and feet of Jesus.
Right.
So before we get started, do you want to say a little prayer and get started with scripture?
Sure, yeah.
All right.
Let's pray over these administration, facilities, and grounds. Yeah. And we didn't really talk about administration, but that's a lot of it also.
Yeah.
That's the newsletters, the telephone, the scheduling, the figuring out when the air conditioner and the fire extinguisher person and all the little running parts of the campus have to be organized. And that's a big part of it too.
And there are so many people involved with that. Not just the people that do it, but the people who plan it. There are teams that we talked about, Board of Trustees, but there are so many other teams that are involved with helping make sure that our facilities run smoothly. And that's part of our administration too. So
okay. Well, let's pray over all that.
All right.
It's so important. So bow with me, please, in a word of prayer. Lord, we are so very thankful for Highland Valley. We are so thankful for Highland Valley, the people that attend church here and their faithfulness that allow all of these things to happen. Lord, you have blessed us with beautiful facilities and gorgeous grounds and administration that just keeps this place running like clockwork. And we are so thankful for all of that, Lord. And we ask your continued blessings on Highland Valley. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. Well, tonight's scripture comes from Acts chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. All right. But as the believers rapidly multiplied, there were rumblings of discontent. The Greek-speaking believers complained about the Hebrew-speaking believers, saying that their widows were being discriminated against in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 called a meeting of all the believers. They said, "We apostles should spend our time teaching the word of God, not running a food program. And so, brothers, select 7 men who are well-respected and are full of the spirit and wisdom. We will give them this responsibility. Then we apostles can spend our time in prayer and teaching the word." Everyone liked this idea, and they chose the following: Stephen, a man full of faith in the Holy Spirit; Philip; Prochorus; Nicanor; Timon; Parmenas; and Nicholas of Antioch, an earlier convert to the Jewish faith. These 7 were presented to the apostles, who prayed for them as they laid their hands on them. So God's message continued to spread. The number of believers greatly increased in Jerusalem, and many of the Jewish priests were converted too.
That the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
All right. Well, joining us now, we have our chair of the Board of Trustees, Julia Baldwin.
Hey there.
Hey, Julia. thanks for joining us.
Glad to be here.
Yeah. Well, we wanted to have you on today. We're talking about administration, and then we're talking about facilities and grounds. Now, we know that the Board of Trustees has a lot to do with our facilities and grounds here at Highland Valley, but for everyone watching, what is the Board of Trustees?
Well, the Board of Trustees consists of 9 members of the church, and we are in charge of a lot of things, both physically and legally. And we make sure that the church is kept up. You know, it's God's house, and we want it to be in good condition all the time. We're responsible for making sure there's adequate insurance on it, people that want to use different rooms, that they have to come through us to get permission for different things like that. So we just pretty much run the physical and maintenance part of the church.
Yeah. So if something breaks in the church, like you get bids. How does that work?
Well, for some things we get bids. We have a dollar amount, if it's over like $1,000, we definitely get 3 bids. But if it's an air conditioner or something like that, we have a contract with an agency that comes out and takes care of that. And they do monthly maintenance or quarterly, whatever's necessary.
Okay, neat.
Yeah. And you mentioned, you know, seeking approval for rooms and things like that. What if someone in the church was really passionate about a cause or an event or anything, like a clothes closet, something like that? What would be the procedure if they had an idea that would require use of facilities for going and or contacting the Board of Trustees? What would happen?
Well, normally a request like that would come through an individual or a committee that, in fact, we're calling them teams instead of committees now.
Right.
They have a grand idea and they think it would really be great for the church and the community. So they kind of do some background work and determine the need, where they would like for it to take place, if it's a weekly thing or a yearly thing. And then they just bring their idea and their questions to the Board of Trustees. And we meet on a quarterly basis and we can meet earlier if necessary. But we determine whether the space is available and if it's adequate, what else they might need to make the event happen. So that's pretty much it. And then the Board of Trustees thinks it over and makes any suggestions or, you know, just goes forward with it.
Yeah. So you made an interesting point there about it may be coming from another team. So if an individual did have an idea about, say, starting a clothes closet, they, for instance, might go to the missions team.
Right.
And talk with them. And then missions team may say, hey, that's a wonderful idea. Let's present that to trustees. And then they would go to the trustees. You guys would think it over, see if it was feasible. And then, you know, potentially next thing you know, we could have a clothes closet or any other thing that someone might be passionate about.
Exactly.
We all started out as small ideas. Even the food pantry, infant care, anything going on in our church started out as someone's passion that went a little bit further, that then went to trustees and was approved.
So. Yeah, and that's what I love about our church is, you know, I've had some ideas, and I've had some that are, you know, crazier than others. But, you know, I've been in front of trustees before and said, hey, what if we did this? And everything that I've had, they've always been like, yeah, do it. That's great. I mean, there are steps, and it does take time. But if you have a good idea, if you have something that you think might work, you can present that. And then trustees may give you the green light and you could start something amazing here at Highland Valley, right?
Exactly. You know, it may take a little bit of work and time to get the exact platform ready, but we can work on things with people like that. You know, we've got a very loving and giving church. And so most ideas like that happen.
Yeah. Well, that's great. Interesting look behind the scenes. Julia, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, you're welcome. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Julia.
See you later. All right. Joining us now, we have Herrn Northcutt. Herrn, thank you for joining us.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Herrn, tonight we're talking about administration, facilities, and grounds. And I know that you've got a lot of experience with that here at Highland Valley. Tell us a little bit about your history here.
Well, I joined the church, in the old church, the old Pride Valley Church, in about 1960 or so. Kind of hung around since then and became a full-time employee of the church. At that time, I was the finance director doing the bookkeeping and payroll and things like that. And then it merged into handling the facilities and the management and the rentals and just everything went along with the church facilities. Anything that happened at the church facilities or needed to happen, then I would be the one that would coordinate that through the trustees, the church staff, and of course, vendors and volunteers. A lot of work that has to be done professionally around here. So I rely a lot on volunteers now, as we did back then, to be able to keep things up to where the lights come on and the doors unlock and all the different things like that. I can think of one of the largest maintenance projects we had around here was several years ago when we developed a gas leak in the middle of wintertime, and it was cold. And we had to, they locked out the meter. Whenever you have a leak, they lock the meter.
No.
So we had to do something. There wasn't any pre-planning on that.
Right.
So contracted a plumber that had done work for us before. And about 3 weeks later, and almost $7,000 later, he got all the leaks. Because every time we'd get one leak fixed, he'd find another one. And that was actually a bargain, too, for all the work he did.
Oh, my.
We tried different things on Sunday. We went out and rented about 10 or 15 floor heaters to put around the sanctuary. So you always knew where people were going to congregate during that time. You see pockets of people. Every place there was a heater, they'd congregate there at the end of the pew.
But right. Oh, my goodness. And that makes me think back here several years ago when we had the issue in the sanctuary that we had to have the repairs done. We had to move into the gym for worship.
For a long time, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when we were doing all the remodeling and things. I was gone from this position then, so I missed most of that, not all of it.
Right, but you've still kept a volunteer role, and there's a lot of things you do. Crystal was talking earlier about, people don't think about things like the sprinklers. Like what goes into upkeeping that?
I don't believe in sprinkler systems myself. I just let the leaves cover everything up. They put the sprinkler system in and everything. It was just constant maintenance. If you've got one at home, there's constant maintenance on it. And our biggest job on that, I get a volunteer to help me. We have to pull the backflow meter, which is not like the little home meter. It's a big giant meter. We have to pull that all every year, drain the system. And then we hook it up, pray that everything still works after being down for 3 or 4 months. So that's always interesting.
Well, Harry, I know you're all over the place. I saw at 1 minute you were in the gym fixing the ceiling tiles, pulling them back down. Then I saw you on your hands and knees in the sanctuary fixing some wood. Then the next thing I knew, you were back in the bathroom trying to fix something back in the men's bathroom. So it's a lot more than people think when they think of maintenance.
Right. And you can take that for granted unless you're one of the people that was around back when the gas leak of whatever year that was, where you had to try to get a good spot next to the floor heater.
Right.
Or if you were in here worshiping, in the gym, mm-hmm. when we couldn't be in the sanctuary. If you're one of those people who remember some situations like that, then you know how important the work that people like you do.
You got to answer my trivia question.
A trivia question
that both of you can answer if you want to, and it goes a lot just how much it is to do around the church. First, you got to realize how much equipment we have. So let me ask you a question. How many ceiling fans do we have?
Oh, my. I'm going to go with...
Over in the gym.
Two.
Yeah, that's all we have. Two. Okay. How many mechanical dishwashers do we have?
I'm going to go with one.
What? I said mechanical on purpose because there are a lot of hand-to-hand dishwashers around here.
No, there's a dishwasher over in Building A in Ben Miller. That's when it was the nursery. There's a dishwasher in there, which is kind of what I was thinking of. And I was thinking, is that mechanical? Is that a different kind? I don't know.
How many showers do we have?
Four.
Yeah.
Very four. Good. Excellent. Excellent. How many sinks do we have?
Oh my goodness.
A lot.
Yeah.
Take a guess between 36 and 38.
37.
Good. Now, how about this will be an easy one. How many toilets do we have?
I don't know if that is easy, Herrn.
I have no idea.
I'm going to say 16.
I was going to say 25.
32.
Oh my goodness. Wow.
A lot.
The whole point is we've got a lot of things, even though we don't have a lot of activity around the church right now, this stuff keeps going on. We have to keep the buildings at least some part of heated and cool to keep them from deteriorating. So that's the whole point, the stuff that keeps going on. So that's dollars well spent through giving. The contributions, which really make a difference. So when we do come back and everybody's here, we're ready to go.
Yes.
That's right. Well, Herrn, thank you so much for that insight.
Very interesting.
We're going to have you back for trivia time soon.
That was fun.
Thanks for everything you do, Herrn.
Thanks, Herrn.
Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Shout your praise, our hearts will
Administrator Tami Bean. Welcome, Tami.
Hey, Tami.
All right, we're talking about the facilities, administration, and grounds, which is kind of mostly your territory. And I know Kimberly helps with a lot of the administration, but tell us a little bit about what those three words mean to you.
Okay, so this is where my work happens. This is actually my whole job is in this part is with our facilities and grounds management of that and our administration here at the church. And so at first I want to talk a little bit about administration. So these are all kinds of things which we probably already mentioned, but this is our website. I think about all the ways we communicate right now. So our website, our Facebook, our how are we updating that? That's administration. That's how we get the word out. You know, the things I do, so our stewardship, our keeping up with our ministry funding plan, you know, being ready to share with our leadership, the finance team, the board of trustees, which we've heard from Julia, you know, to be able to share with them where we are, how is the funding, where we are with that. It's things like our copier. You know, folks may not even think about copiers much anymore. We're in such a digital world, but we still make thousands of copies every month. And even during coronavirus, we've actually, someone's had more because we've done letters or sent things out. And we spend like 15% of our ministry funding plan on that. So when people give, they're giving towards all these things that kind of happen really behind the scenes, you know, not like worship or music where we see it. It's all happening behind the scenes. And then when I think about facilities and grounds, so that one seems a little more obvious, right? We think about our buildings. We think about the grass out front. We're so grateful, you know, Herrn is just really helping us in our stewardship of that and our care of that. And so we're grateful for that. And, you know, we have two grounds to take care of, though. Sometimes we forget about Walnut Grove. So that includes taking care of that church, making sure we have a little electricity out there, making sure the grounds don't get overgrown by the jungle of trees out there. And then all of the things here, which when we think about sometimes these two areas, I do want to share this. I feel like sometimes these two areas we don't get as excited about because we go, oh gosh, it's electricity. It's water. It's, you know, it's waste management who comes and graciously gets our, you know, gets our recycling and trash. But to me, I just want to say it's as vital as all the other things we do, because if we don't have this space, we cannot do the missions and ministries we do. All the things we're celebrating are happening because we do have an office with some computers set up in it, because we do have a building that the food pantry can still operate out of. And so I just encourage folks to be excited about our administration here at the church and our grounds and our facilities. And that just to remember, it's such an important part of our ministry funding plan. Maybe it doesn't feel as spiritual or something, but it really is, because this is where it all happens. And this is where it doesn't all happen here, but this is also, if it's not happening here, this is where we send people out to know Christ and share Christ. It's from here.
Yeah.
Right.
And you're right. You do take it for granted. But if you did go in the sanctuary and those lights didn't come on, and
or the TVs didn't work, or I said in Sunday school on Sunday, like, kids, I came in, I turned the lights on, and the heater worked. I have this Bible in my hand that I can read. That's all because of all our facilities and everything that goes into taking care of them.
Yeah, and on a more broad scale, you think of, what if it wasn't even there, period?
Yeah.
I mean, we talk about the lights and all those things, but sometimes I think we may take our facilities for granted. And this is where everything, like you said, got started. It's, things are different right now because it's, we're virtual in so many ways. We still have to have facilities, and we're still doing so much from here. But you mentioned the website earlier being such a big part of the administration. Well, right now it feels like the website's such a big part of our facilities.
It's our digital facility. Our website is.
Right.
It's how you get in the door. Real. I mean, for a lot of people, it's what they're checking and going to most often.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important as we go forward, you know, because, you know, we will get back to some form of normal sooner, hopefully, rather than later, and be able to take advantage of our facilities. And I think it'll be a good time for us to start thinking about, you know, how we can better utilize these spaces to glorify God.
And how we can share, you know, this, prior to COVID, you know, we really have amazing facilities. We just did this building swap. So really all of our buildings are kind of freshened up with fresh paint and new spaces. And, you know, there are lots of needs in the community that we might could meet through our facilities and grounds. So not a food pantry, but to let maybe recovery groups use our space, or, you know, they're just folks in the community. And so I'm excited when we come out of this, that maybe our facilities will be used every day of the week. Maybe sometimes by Highland Valley folks, but maybe by folks in the community, that this would be a safe and welcoming space that they could come serve each other and help serve alongside us. So, I mean, I think that's going to be a wonderful opportunity to be in fellowship with our neighbors through a different means. It's kind of a different outreach, I think, if we think about our facilities that way.
Right. And when we think about our congregation being a part of that, being a part of our facilities, our grounds, our administration, maybe you're not a Herrn Northcutt or a Linda Bear or a Tami Bean, but you're still a part of this, right, Tami?
Absolutely. So again, and I know I kind of say this in some way every week, but when you give, you automatically become a part of the whole ministry funding plan. So you automatically become a part of what I do and what Herrn's doing, or what the board of trustees are doing, or, you know, what Kimberly's doing on our website, or what the staff, you know, what you guys do on our website. You automatically are in ministry with us. You have become a part of that ministry through that gift every time.
Right. Well, great. Well, thank you so much again, Tami. This has been wonderful.
Yes. I love behind the scenes.
Yes.
Love it.
Yeah. So that's it for this week. And next week, you can join us back again as we celebrate.
Mission and outreach.
And outreach. We've celebrated a lot.
We have.
Like, checking off. What have we done? What's next? Mission and outreach.
Yes. Mission and outreach. So that's going to be great. That's going to be leading us up right to Thanksgiving. So we have a lot to be thankful for. So thank you again, Tami, for joining us.
Yeah. Thanks for having me. See you guys next time.
All right, see y'all next week.
Bye. Celebrate. It's all right.